Nosy neighbor notices creepy van in driveway next door and makes difficult decision. It was a quiet American neighborhood, not unlike your own. It was the early 2000s, and though the age of children playing in their front yards and down suburban streets had long since passed, there were still some towns where things were safe enough for that sort of thing to continue. Unfortunately for 11-year-old Sean Hornbeck, despite all appearances to the contrary, this was not one of those neighborhoods. Sean Hornbeck was 11 years old when he disappeared not far from his family home in Richwoods, Missouri. It was a cool October day in 2002, and it had started like any other Sunday for Sean. He, like he did every week, was riding his bike down the road to his friend's house. Sean had taken this same path many times before, only this time he ran afoul of a strange man in a truck as he rode. The man stopped the truck and ran out to see if Sean was all right, but a moment later he grabbed the boy and shoved him into the back of the truck, saying, "You were just at the wrong place at the wrong time." Sean's parents found out he was missing soon after, but by the time they got the call, it was already too late. Over the next few years, they focused all of their time looking for their son. In time, they even set up a foundation to help look for missing and abducted children, the Sean Hornbeck Foundation. Sean's disappearance caught the attention of all Missourians. Within a matter of days, the entire nation knew about the boy's disappearance and was doing their best to help Sean's parents to find him. At the same time, Sean's parents were expending an ever-increasing amount of their time and money trying to find him. By the time it was all said and done, Sean's mother and stepfather spent all their money and retirement savings looking for their son. Apparently, they'd been paying investigators to help aid the police for months. Sean Hornbeck would remain missing for 4 years. The man who had taken Sean Hornbeck, 40-year-old Michael Devlin, had taken the boy to his home in Kirkwood, Missouri. The first month of Sean's captivity was spent with the 11-year-old strapped to a futon with his mouth taped shut. It seemed that at first Devlin didn't know what to do with the boy. Almost immediately, Devlin began to threaten the boy with guns. He told Sean that if he ever thought about leaving or calling for help, he'd murder him and bury him where no one would find him. Sean was completely terrified of even trying to escape, and after he had untied him from the futon, things got worse. He made Sean take on the last name Devlin and presented the boy as his son when police came knocking on an unrelated arrest warrant. When he wasn't beating and repeatedly abusing the young boy, he exploited him by forcing him to make pornographic videos for his pleasure. This terrible behavior can be linked to Devlin's own childhood. As a child, Devlin grew and was adopted into a large family. With the family, he learned that having three brothers and two sisters wasn't easy. Once he reached adulthood, Devlin worked as a manager for Emo's Pizza in Kirkwood, and then as a part-time funeral home worker at the Bop Chapel. Friends noticed that the man, who had once been so outgoing, became a much quieter person after he developed diabetes and had to have two toes amputated in 2002. It was a sad and lonely life, and Devlin's clear homosexual and pederastic tendencies had no outlet. Sean, it seemed, fit those needs. Eventually, though, as the years passed, Sean became too old for Devlin's particular tastes. Despite the boy's complete subservience to him in every way, and despite the fact that he'd been captive for over 4 years, Devlin decided he needed a younger replacement. And so Devlin decided to kidnap another local 13-year-old boy named Ben Ownby on January 8, 2007. Unfortunately, Devlin wasn't so lucky this time around. The kidnapped boy's 15-year-old neighbor saw Devlin's truck on the day of the abduction and immediately knew something was wrong when he saw Ben crying and the truck peeling away from the bus stop at top speed. The young neighbor was able to give a perfect description of the white truck to the police, and in no time at all, the FBI linked the truck to Devlin. Once the police noticed the truck in Devlin's driveway, they knew they had to approach with caution, just in case the suspect used Ben as a shield. They still didn't know that Sean was inside. Of course, Devlin had no idea he'd been seen at the bus stop, and when the FBI showed up at the door, he was understandably surprised. They asked him about the kidnapping, and his distant, nervous avoidance behavior gave them their first clue. He also kept referring to his godson, Sean, who was inside and apparently needed his help. The FBI quickly realized that the Sean the man was referring to must have been the missing Sean Hornbeck. If that were true, it meant that he was still alive, and if he were still alive, so was Ben Ornby. They charged in, and before long, both children were rescued and returned to their families. On January 12, 2007, the FBI took Michael Devlin into custody. It had been 4 days since he kidnapped 13-year-old Ben Ownby. He was charged with the abduction of Ben and Sean Hornbeck. Yet, that wasn't the only thing the FBI had been looking at Devlin for. Before long, prosecutors and investigators from Washington, Franklin, St. Louis, and Lincoln counties, as well as the FBI, the Missouri State Highway Police, and Kirkwood and St. Charles Police, formed a task force. They were going to investigate Devlin's possible involvement in a number of other unsolved cases in respective jurisdictions. When it was all said and done, Michael Devlin was charged with 80 counts of sexual assault, kidnapping, and attempted murder. Sean had told them everything. With no recourse, Devlin pled guilty to all counts and was sentenced to 72 life terms. As for the two formerly missing boys? In a strange twist, it seemed that Sean Hornbeck had actually been allowed out of Devlin's house during his capture. He had often been seen in public, he even had a girlfriend, walked around a local shopping mall, and spoke with a police officer when his bicycle was stolen. Yet, no one had recognized him. Still, in the end, both Ben and Sean are back with their families, attempting to live as normal a life as possible after suffering such horrors at the hands of Michael Devlin. Thanks to his parents' efforts, the Sean Hornbeck Foundation still works to help find other missing and abducted children. Please share this video with your friends below.